Hello friends, today we are going to discuss mandala theory of Kautilya given in Arthashastra. Kautilya was an ancient Indian political philosopher who has written the great work called Arthashastra. In his Arthashastra, Kautilya has given so many details about the administration, the state, and also about the statecraft. So, the Arthashastra deals about the Saptanga theory, the Mandala theory, and the scheme of administration in the statecraft. So, today we are going to discuss the Mandala theory given by Kautilya in his great work Arthashastra. In fact, Kautilya wrote this Arthashastra as a code of manual for all the administrators. It gives details about politics, administration, social order, and so many other things. That's why Arthashastra is also considered as an interdisciplinary academic work that deals with issues of political science, economics, sociology, and various interrelated disciplines. So Mandala theory is a theory given by Kautilya in his great work Arthashastra. Mandala theory provides balance of power to king in assertion of supremacy. In good olden days, the monarchy was considered as an ideal form of government, and in which the king was the chieftain in any government. So in maintaining balance of power in the comity of states in and around the kingdom, and the need to maintain supremacy of the king over other kings, Mandala theory provides certain tactics. So Mandala theory is basically a theory that provides some of the techniques for maintaining balance of power to the king in assertion of supremacy in the comity of states. So Mandala theory states that there are 12 kings in any region. This is called circular of states. So in this circular of states, Mandala theory is considered as a means for predicted diplomacy. So this theory enunciated that the problems and crisis situations in any state can be resolved through peaceful means. So there are two means through which any problem or any crisis can be settled. One is the non-violent diplomacy method, that's called the peaceful resolution of conflicts. The second one is more aggressive, violent and methods of war. So this is how Mandala theory, it's basically a means for predicted diplomacy. It provides more emphasis on diplomacy. Diplomacy means peaceful resolution of conflicts. So that's why it is called predicted diplomacy. So Mandala theory, in which a circular of states maintains good relations among themselves, and this theory provides a means for the predicted diplomacy. Likewise, Mandala theory of Kautilya is a strategic imperative for maintaining sovereignty. This theory not only provides a peaceful means and diplomatic means for maintaining supremacy, but it also gives a kind of a strategy or a war strategy for the king for maintaining the sovereignty. Sovereignty is the soul of any kingdom or any state. Without sovereignty, no state can exist. So for maintaining the sovereignty or the supreme power of the state or its citizens and territories is called sovereignty. So sovereignty should be maintained by the king, by the state. So for the maintenance of sovereignty, this Mandala theory of Kautilya is a strategic imperative. It provides the strategy, it provides the defense inputs for maintaining the sovereignty to any state that is situated in a group of states. So a group of states is called as a mandala. This group consists of 12 states in which Kautilya provides a strategic imperative for maintaining sovereignty. This mandala theory provides the strategic inputs for maintaining sovereignty of the state by the king. So this is another important aspect of mandala theory. Thirdly, mandala theory of Kautilya provides a blueprint and a roadmap for territorial expansion. So any king, if he wants to expand himself, expand his territory beyond the borders and wage wars or involve in external aggressions, this mandala theory provides a blueprint or a roadmap for territorial expansion. So mandala theory of Kautilya is a predictive diplomacy, it's a strategic imperative, and it also provides a blueprint, it's a roadmap for a territorial expansion. If the king wants to expand his territory and expand his borders or wage wars with the neighboring kings or any other kings, mandala theory of Kautilya provides a blueprint and a roadmap, and it also provides suggestions on war preparedness or defense preparedness of the king. So it's in a way, it's a blueprint. It's a roadmap for territorial expansion of the king. Expanding the territory of the king is also needed for the king to draw legitimacy from the people. That's why in good old Indian kings always used to wage wars, and waging war was also was considered as sacred objective of the king. So mandala theory of Kautilya provides a blueprint or the way or a roadmap for territorial expansion. And mandala theory had also sixfold foreign policy as an inherent part. So within mandala theory, Kautilya also provides various principles of foreign policy. What is a foreign policy? A foreign policy is a policy that describes the relations with the neighboring kings and other kings, neighboring states and other states. That's called as foreign policy. In post-independence period, India also has a foreign policy, and Nehru is considered as the father of Indian foreign policy in the modern times. But having foreign policy to a state is not a new phenomenon, and it has been there since immemorial. And during the ancient times also, all the states used to have a foreign policy for themselves in maintaining good relations with the neighboring kings and other kings. So mandala theory provides a sixfold path. There are six principles on maintaining foreign policy, and this sixfold foreign policy is also an inherent part of the mandala theory. And after that, it explains the defense strategy for state aggrandizement or extension of borders. Mandala theory explains the strategy, the defense strategy. It provides the defense output, defense inputs for state aggrandizement or expansion of the state and extension of borders. So it's in a way a defense strategy. So mandala theory is considered as a very valuable theory in Arthashastra as a predictive diplomacy and also a strategic imperative and a defense strategy for state aggrandizement. And also, it has also a sixfold foreign policy as an inherent part. So it explains the defense strategy for the state aggrandizement or extension of borders. Now let us see. Now today's lesson, we'll plan our lesson in such a way that first we'll discuss the description of mandala theory and its importance. In fact, the discussion is almost taking place right in the beginning of this lesson. First, we'll describe the mandala theory and its importance. That's called as the description of mandala theory. In fact, mandala theory was discussed in the great academic work of Kautilya called Arthashastra. In Arthashastra, as a part of Rajadharma, he has discussed the Mandala theory and suggested the king to have good relations with the neighboring kings, and the king should maintain supremacy or sovereignty among the groups of nations around him. So that's why Mandala theory describes the foreign policy and relations, the patterns of relations between one state and the other states in the good olden times. So first of all, we'll discuss the description of Mandala theory. After that, the Mandala theory's main proposition that there are 12 kings in any region and the native king is in the middle and surrounded by 11 kings around him. So how a king maintains relations with other kings is a matter of Mandala theory. So description of these 12 kings, who are the other 12 kings, who are the 11 kings around the king. The king himself is a hero, is considered as a conqueror or a Vijigishu. Vijigishu means a person to be prepared, to get prepared for a war or a predicted diplomacy and get victory. He's called as a conqueror. And a Vijigishu is surrounded by 11 other kings. So the Mandala theory describes the other kings. Now we'll also describe, let us know the description of the 12 kings. And thirdly, what are the objectives of Mandala theory? As I told you in the beginning itself, Mandala theory has an objective of maintaining sovereignty of the state and territorial integrity of the state. And besides that, it also has other objectives. And we'll discuss that as a part of our lesson plan. After that, we'll discuss the advantages of Mandala theory. There are certain advantages with Mandala theory, and it provides a blueprint for the territorial expansion. It also is a means for a predicted diplomacy. It is also gives some techniques on strategic imperatives, strategic defense preparedness, and other things. So there are so many advantages with the Mandala strategy, and we'll discuss those Mandala strategy also, advantages of Mandala strategy. After that, Mandala theory discusses about the sixfold foreign policy or the Mandala strategy. There are six patterns or six forms of maintaining relations with other states, ranging from peaceful relations to animosity relations, waging war to maintaining peace. So in between there are around six strategies. So Mandala theory gives a detailed description of the sixfold foreign policy as an inherent part of the Mandala strategy. And after that, what are the tactics of the king? The king also need to have some five tactics, and Mandala theory provides the five tactics. So as a part of our lesson plan, we'll also discuss the five tactics of the king. And after that, we'll be discussing about diplomacy, warfare, and espionage. Espionage means maintaining spy and maintaining some people to get some secret information going on in other countries, other states, through some of the spies deployed or employed by the king. So that's called as the espionage activity. So espionage is not new. Even today we have so many secret agencies. So getting information from our neighboring kingdoms, neighboring states, about the social order, law and order problems, and defense preparedness, and other things. We get information, and even other countries also sometimes employ their own secret agents in various countries and try to gather some information, secret information about the country. So, as part of the Mandala theory, Kautilya discussed about diplomacy, warfare, and espionage. So lastly, we'll be concluding everything. So this is our lesson plan. Now let us discuss the description of mandala theory. First of all, mandala theory is given in Kautilya's Arthashastra. First of all, we should know about mandala. What is a mandala? A mandala is a committee of 12 states, a group of 12 states in which the native king situates in the middle and surrounded by 11 other kings. That's called as a mandala. So mandala theory provides the strategy for maintaining balance of power. So all the countries are powerful, all the states are powerful. So every state wants to be powerful, and some states even want to be superpowers. So in such a situation, how a native state maintains its balance of power with other countries is a matter of mandala theory. So it provides a strategy for maintaining balance of power among various states, how the power can be balanced. No power should go more powerful than the other states. And no power should lag behind in terms of power in all other countries, in the eyes of other countries. That's how every country wants to maintain the balance. So that's called as the balance of power. So mandala theory provides a strategy for maintaining the balance of power. And after that, it's a predicted diplomacy. In the beginning, I have told you, it's not only a strategic roadmap, it also provides the means to maintain diplomacy and maintain good relations through discussions and negotiations. If there is a crisis situation between two states, mandala theory provides the tactics and techniques on maintaining diplomacy and peaceful resolution of conflicts. So if the conflict is peacefully resolved between the states, so that's called as diplomacy. So diplomacy is a means of maintaining peace. And through diplomacy, all the conflicts have to be resolved in a very peaceful means. So mandala theory provides a predicted diplomacy. It predicts diplomacy and it manages the crisis management. And after that, mandala theory is a strategic imperative for sovereignty. In the beginning, I have told you about the sovereign power, sovereignty. The very concept of sovereignty means supreme power of the state or its people or its citizens or its subjects and its territories is called as sovereignty. Sovereignty has two dimensions. One is internal sovereignty, the other one is external sovereignty. Internal sovereignty means the state should maintain its supreme power or its citizens and their associations. That's called as internal sovereignty. All the people should obey the state. Getting obedience to the state as a matter of habit, all people should show obedience to the state. So this habitual obedience getting from people and their association towards the state is called as the internal sovereignty. And likewise, if any state maintains political independence without being succumbing to the pressures and pulls of other countries and maintaining its independence in matters of policy formulation and enactments, that's called as political independence or external sovereignty. So maintaining sovereignty, both internally and externally, internal sovereignty and external sovereignty, is a challenge to the state. So this mandala theory provides a strategic imperative for sovereignty. Mandala theory provides a strategic imperative for maintaining sovereignty by any king. And it also provides a roadmap for a territorial expansion. So sometimes the king wants to expand his kingdoms. The state wants to expand its borders. So that's called as state aggrandizement or territorial expansion. So in matters of territorial expansion, how the state should go as a strategy, as a matter of strategy, to expand its territories by waging wars, by making negotiations, by making bargains. How the state go about in territorial expansion is a matter of roadmap. So this roadmap is provided by Mandala theory. So Mandala theory provides a roadmap for a territorial expansion of a state or the territories of other states. So that's called as Mandala theory. Mandala theory provides for that. So now let us discuss in detail about Mandala theory. As I've told you in the beginning itself, Mandala means 12 kings in a circle. 12 kings in a circle is called as a mandala. So in these 12 kings, the first king is called as the conqueror or Vijigishu. Vijigishu means a person who wants always victory is called as a conqueror or the king. So the king sits in the middle. The king locates himself, situates himself in the middle in a circle of 11 other kings surrounded by him. So this is called as a mandala. Mandala means 12 kings. The king is one, king is the conqueror, king is the Vijigishu, and king is always counted by Ari. Ari means the enemy. And the king and the enemy king, always have at loggerheads to make aggressions against each other and to gain territorial expansion at the cost of the other king. So this is called as enemy king and the native king. The enemy king is called Ari. Ari in Sanskrit means the enemy. And third one is Mitra. Mitra means every king need to have a friend. So the king with friendly relations with another king is called as the Mitra. And the fourth one is Arimitra. Arimitra means enemy's friend. So not only the enemy, but also enemy's friend is also a threat to the king. So the king should always think about the enemy and also about the friends of his enemy. So they are called as Arimitra. Arimitra means the friend of an enemy. If the king wants to wage a war against his enemy, he should think not only about his own strength and not only about the strength of his enemy, but he should also think about the strengths and weaknesses of the enemy and also the strengths and weaknesses of the surrounding friendly countries of his enemy. So Arimitra. Arimitra means a friend of enemy. So the king should also have a detailed account of preparedness of the enemy and also his friend of the enemy. So this is called Arimitra. And fifth one is Mitramitra. Mitramitra means friend's friend of the king. King has a friend and that friend has another king as a friend. So friend's friend of the king is called Arimitra. So these are the five kings. And after that, Arimitramitra. Arimitramitra means enemy's friend's friend. Enemy's friend's friend. The king should also be wary. He should always be threatened by not only by enemy, but also the friends of enemy and friends of enemy. Enemy's friends also may have other friends. Enemy has a friend and that friend also may have other friends. They are called enemy's friend's friend. Arimitra Mitra. Arimitra Mitra. So they are called as enemy's friend's friend. So when the king wants to make a strategy, war strategy, he should have a full information about the strengths and weaknesses of the enemy and also the friend of the enemy and also friend of the friend's enemy. So this is called as Arimitra Mitra. And seventh one is the rearward enemy. And eighth one is the rearward friend. So for every king, there is always another king who always criticizes him. So the one who is very critical of the king is called as a rearward enemy. And the king also have a friend who is always wishes well for the king. A rearward friend. A rearward friend and a rearward enemy. So the king also should have more knowledge about a rearward enemy and rearward king. Rearward friend. a rearward enemy, a rearward friend. These two kings also, both they support the king and also oppose the king. And the friend of a rearward enemy and the friend of a rearward friend. So this is how the king need to have full information about himself, his enemy, his friends' friends, and his friends' friends' friends. Likewise, he need to have full knowledge about his enemy, enemy's friends, enemy's friends' friends. So all the 12 kings, and there are also other two more kings. One is intermediary and the other one is neutral. There is always a neutral king who makes judgments. That's called as a neutral king. A neutral king is always needed for getting justice. In case the king is not in a position to win a war, he need to have an intermediary and a neutral king to mediate on behalf of the king with the enemy. So they are called as intermediaries and neutral kings. So this is how there are 12 kings. The king located in the center of the circle, consisting of 12 kings. Ari, the enemy. Mitra, the friend of the king. Arimitra, friend of the enemy. Mitra, friend of friends, the friend of the king. Arimitra, enemy's friend's friend. A rearward enemy, a rearward friend. A friend of a rearward enemy, a friend of a rearward friend. Intermediary and a neutral king. Intermediary king and a neutral king. So this is how a group of 12 kings is called as a mandala. And if the king wants to expand his territory or to mediate with other kings, he should take into account the strength and weaknesses of all the 12 kings. So this is called as the mandala theory. In mandala theory, there are 12 kings. Once again, let us discuss it. The first one is the king or the conqueror who locates in the middle of the circle, and the king is always countered by enemy king, that's called Ari, and the king is always helped by a friend, that's called friend of the king, Mitra, and the enemy's king also have a friend, that's called a friend of the enemy, and king also have a friend and a friend's friend. Arimitra Mitra, Mitra Mitra. And likewise, enemy's friend also may also have a friend. Enemy's friend's friend. A rearward enemy, a rearward friend, a friend of a rearward enemy, a friend of a rearward friend, intermediary and neutral king. So this is how every kingdom is located in a comity of at least 11 kings. And these 12 kings in a circle is called as a mandala. So even if the king wants to strategically win a war or to negotiate with other kings over the issues of any crisis or external expansion or any external aggression, so the king needs to have a knowledge about these 12 kings. So these 12 kings in a circle is called as a mandala. So the relations of one king with all the other 11 kings is described in mandala theory. Mandala theory describes the relations of one king with all the 11 kings, both in terms of war and also in terms of peace. So this is called as the mandala theory. What are the objectives of mandala theory? As I have told you in the beginning itself, one of the important objectives of mandala theory is to maintain sovereignty. Sovereignty is called as supreme power of the state. As I have told you in the beginning, sovereignty has two dimensions, internal sovereignty and external sovereignty. Internal sovereignty means the supreme power of the state or its citizens and their territories is called as internal sovereignty. External sovereignty means maintaining political independence and without yielding to the pleasures of the other kings, the king should be independent in formulating his own policies and making enactments that political independence is called as external sovereignty. So the king should be in a position to maintain his sovereign power. So to maintain this sovereign power, the mandala theory provides some techniques to the king, with whom he should befriend, with whom he should have animistic relations. So if the king is in a crisis situation, the king should mobilize his support from his friends, friendly kings, Mitra, Mitra Mitra, reared friend and others. And if the king is in crisis situation, he should assess the strength and weaknesses of his enemy kings. Ari, an enemy king, Ari Mitra, that means enemy's friend, Ari Mitra Mitra, enemy's friend's friend, and also a reared enemy, an enemy who is always critical of the king, a reared friend of an enemy. So this is how, if the king wants to win a war or wants to maintain relations with other kings, good relations. So this mandala theory provides a blueprint. So that's how it is very necessary for having maintenance of sovereignty. And secondly, for achieving territorial integrity, for achieving territorial safety, the king need to have the mandala strategy. So second objective of mandala theory is to provide a strategy for maintaining territorial integrity. And thirdly, territorial expansion. If the king wants to wage a war or maintain territorial expansion, expanding the borders and making an external aggression or war, the king need to have the mandala strategy. So mandala theory provides a strategic policy, a roadmap for maintaining both territorial integrity and also territorial expansion. And fourthly, it gives legitimacy to the king. Mandala theory provides legitimacy to the king by making the king supreme or his subjects. So once the king remains a victor in times of war, in times of crisis, people's trust and confidence or the king enhances. That enhancement of trust of people or the king is called legitimacy. So the king draws legitimacy from the people through the mandala strategy. So mandala theory provides a strategy for bringing legitimacy to the king. Legitimacy for the act of a war, legitimacy for the act of maintaining good relations with the countries. So maintenance of territorial expansion or making war against other countries. So for all the activities of the king, for all the actions of the king, people's obedience, people's acceptance is very much needed. So that acceptance of the people, the law obedience or citizens' obedience of the state or state obedience to the state, may be called as the legitimacy. And this much needed legitimacy of the king from the people is provided by the mandala strategy of mandala theory. And mandala theory also provides a strategic foreign policy. It's the main objective of the mandala theory is to provide strategic foreign policy to the king. In fact, foreign policy has six important patterns or forms. Now let us discuss what are the six important foreign policy forms of foreign policy. A foreign policy is a policy formulated for maintaining good relations, neutral relations or enemistic relations with other states. This is called as a foreign policy. So every state need to have a foreign policy. We have American foreign policy, Indian foreign policy, Chinese foreign policy, Russian foreign policy, Australian foreign policy, Japanese foreign policy. So basically, foreign policy is a policy that denotes the pattern of relations with one state against other states is called as a foreign policy. So foreign policy also have some objectives. Foreign policy also have political expediencies, and it also maintains and reflects the interests of the state. So there are six forms of foreign policy discussed inherently as part of Mandala theory. The first one is the king always requires coexistence with other countries, other states. So coexistence is the first strategy. In a coexistence, the king always wants to maintain good relations with other states. And for all the goods and evils, the king disregards the evils and he maintains relations with other countries as a matter of cohabitation or coexistence. In fact, the Panchsheel Agreement between India and China has a principle of peaceful coexistence. So that means all the countries should coexist with each other and they should strive for the development of each country by themselves with the help of other countries. So coexistence is very much required for the development and growth of any country, and nowadays to enhance the foreign capital or to attract foreign direct investment and to increase the per capita incomes of the state and to improve the human development indicators of the people. The coexistence of all the countries with each other in a friendly manner is very much required, and this requirement is noted by our philosopher Kautilya in his book Arthashastra, and he says coexistence is the first form of foreign policy. And secondly, all the countries need to have alliances. Alliances means friendly relations among themselves. So no country is independent. Though theoretically political independence is there, all countries are dependent on each other. No country can survive without the help and assistance of other countries. So that's why there are political interests, economic interests, and other interests. So to maintain these interests and to satisfy these interests, alliances with other countries is very much required. So alliance, friendly relations with other countries, is another important foreign policy. And third one is neutrality. If the king or if the state has some problem with other countries, he need to have either negative relations or positive relations or neutral relations. So neutrality means neither positive nor negative relations. So that's called indifferent relations. Policy of indifference or policy of neutrality. And fourth one is double-edged policy. Double-edged policy means sometimes positive relations and sometimes negative relations. Sometimes having friendly relations and sometimes aggressive relations. So the relations with other countries always change according to circumstances and political expediencies. So if the political necessities and experiences demand the state to have good relations with other countries, sometimes, and sometimes these experiences and interests demand the state to have animosity relations with other countries. So the state need to have both positive relations and also negative relations. This is called double-edged policy. And the fifth one is marche forme. Marche forme means, though there is no external aggression as such, but the country need to march the army on the borders so that its defense preparedness is well noted by the neighboring kings. So when the neighboring kings note about the defense preparedness of the native king, they also do not involve in mischievous things, or they keep themselves away from deceit or negative things. That's why march of army is an important form of maintaining political foreign policy. In fact, in the recent past, in the relations between India and China, the march of army is also held in Galwan Valley, Indian army marching against the presence of Russian Chinese army. So march of army is an important aspect of foreign policy. We are practicing it now, but this is well noted in the 6th century and 5th century BC itself by Kautilya in his Arthashastra as part of the Mandala strategy. And sixth one is war. Every country should be prepared to maintain war or wage war against the other countries for the protection and for the fulfillment of its own political interests and economic interests. So protection and maintenance of interests, economic interests and political interests is the basic necessity of every country. And if these interests are not protected, every country sometimes prepare itself for a war with the neighboring countries. So this is how there are six types of relations between two states. One is coexistence, the other one is alliance, third one is neutrality, fourth one is double-edged policy, fifth one is match of army, and sixth one is war. So this six-fold foreign policy is described as part of Mandala strategy in the Mandala theory by Kautilya in his Arthashastra. And king need to have five tactics with the other kings, with the neighboring kings and other kings. First of all, he should have the conciliation strategy. Conciliation means peaceful relations, peaceful resolution of conflicts. That's called as conciliation. Second one is appeasement or gifting. If the other king is mightier, if the king is stronger, the native king also befriend with other countries by giving some gifts, by having relations, personal relations with the other kings. This is called as the policy of appeasement, tactics of appeasement. And the other kings are always stubborn. Then in the king need to have dissension. Dissension means expressing dissent is called dissension. And sometimes the king also need to have deceit and pretense. He need to deceive other kings, and he need to pretend himself and maintain negative relations with other kings. And lastly, the king also undertake open attack or war to maintain his relations, to maintain his interests, political interests or economic interests in the form of a war. So these are the five tactics of a king. Now let us see what are the advantages of Mandala theory. Mandala theory provides a formula for diplomacy. Diplomacy means peaceful resolution of conflicts. So it's a strategy for maintaining good relations among countries. There's a neutral king, there's an intermediary king, and if there's a war between king and his enemy, the neutral king always maintains neutrality with both the kings, and at times, if the time needed, then the king renders his justice, the neutral king renders justice and make bargains with the other kings. So diplomacy is one important aspect, and Mandala strategy also provides supremacy. It provides tactics for maintaining supremacy, and it also provides tactics for territorial expansion. So these are all the advantages of Mandala theory. Now let us conclude our lesson by saying that Mandala theory is a defense strategy. It provides the king all the defense preparedness, and it's a foreign policy guide to maintain either positive relations or negative relations. And in the interstate relations, it provides some guidelines for the king and the state in the maintenance of interstate relations. Sometimes Mandala theory also provides a moral indifference, and to conquer the king, to conquer the neighboring kingdoms or to make territorial expansions, the king should not oblige himself to the moral standards, and morals and politics are to be separated, and king also maintain moral indifference. And the king should always give importance to political expediency. So Mandala theory states that political expediency or maintenance of political interests and economic interests has a much higher pedestal than other things. So political expediency is another important aspect. But in spite of these advantages with mandala theory, it has also certain disadvantages. It provides Machiavellian tactics of deceit, tactics of treason. So these are all called as the Machiavellian tactics. The king, by hook or crook, he wants to expand his territory and make state aggrandizement. For making state aggrandizement a success and to expand his borders, the king sometimes need to apply Machiavellian tactics. So those Machiavellian tactics they sometimes appear to be morally incorrect, but Kautilya suggests the Machiavellian tactics. And Kautilya glorifies the territorial expansion of the state. So this is how he glorifies the war, he glorifies the territorial expansion. So mandala theory provides a blueprint for defense preparedness and a blueprint for predicted diplomacy, and it's a strategy for maintaining relations among the countries. So this is all about mandala theory. Thank you, friends. Thank you very much.